Our illustrious panel is joined now from the Foxwood Casino in Connecticut. That's the largest casino in the United States, and the most successful one is on an Indian reservation. The man who opened that casino was Frank Sinatra. Mm-hmm. The man playing there now is Paul Anka, and he joins us. We finally got our satellites straightened out. Paul, you and, first of all, there's a plaque there commemorating Sinatra's appearance there, isn't there?
Yes, there is. That's right, Larry.
Your feeling about hearing the news today?
Well, we all expected it, obviously. You're never quite ready for it. My wife, Ann, called me last night, in the middle of the night, and Steve Wynn and I had had dinner prior to that in New York. And I called Steve, and we conversed a lot more about it. We were kind of reminiscing to some people at the table with us, because we're all doing that gig out in Vegas the end of May with Quincy and everyone. And it was, you're moved by it. You know, I was quite emotional. We've lost someone, a great entertainer. Society lost a very charitable man.
Did you write My Way for him?
Yes, I did.
That was a French song, right? A French tune.
Yeah. And then it's to where it wound up.
Right. And it took a while before he recorded it, right?
Actually, I spent some time with him in Miami and came home, wrote it, and I think he recorded it about 6 months later.
Did he like it right away?
The reaction from Frank on a lot of things, if you got a kooky out of him, that meant he was hilarious. He was not an animated guy in that sense all the time.
He also slept rather late, right, Don? Sammy Kahn tells stories that when Frank says see you in the morning, it meant 3 o'clock.
What do you, I don't make up his bed. How do I know?
I'm asking you. You work for him. You travel.
Well, I don't check when he sleeps. Well, do you think I stand over the bed? He's sleeping.
No, I mean.
No, well, most
he's
of
a
us.
He's a man.
Most
yeah,
of
he
us
did,
the,
he did sleep late. Well, he had to dry out.
I think.
But, you know. Sorry.
That's what we always have to remember, too, because Frank, outside of being this great artist, this man knew how to party, play as well as he did work. And he could party the art out of party, the ART.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing left but a PY.
We had a thing. We were in Monte Carlo. And, you know, he loved Monte Carlo. So we get invited to Monte Carlo. Frank says, come on, join us. Barbara and I, we go to Monte Carlo. And Jilly, rest his soul, that was his good friend and my good friend. All of us, you know, Jilly. And when we got up in the morning, we were in the Hermitage, and he was in the Hotel de Paris, in the penthouse, you know, and Prince Rene was making the room up. he was in there, and Jilly said, listen, every morning when Frank gets up, don't leave the room till I give you the signal. And like, I thought it was Diary of Anne Frank. We were in the room with the curtains, and we go out, and you see a pink napkin, Jilly said. That means Frank's up. A white napkin means stay in bed. We were in bed once for 3 days, waiting for Jilly to come out on the balcony with a pink napkin. You know the Pope with the smoke? That was faster.
We'll be right back. This is a celebration of Sinatra. Don't go away.
What is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not. Not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the gold and did it my way.
A celebration of the life of Francis Albert Sinatra, dead at 82 and a half years old. We will replay our entire interview with Frank one night next week on Larry King Live. Our panelists are Steve Lawrence, here in Los Angeles, in New York, Vic Damone, here in L.A., Don Rickles, in Las Vegas, Debbie Reynolds, who starred with Frank in The Tender Trap, in Shamrock, Texas, Ernie Borgnine, Academy Award winner himself, who was in the movie, of course, where Frank won his Best Supporting Actor role. In Foxwoods Casino in Connecticut, Paul Anka. Here in the L.A. Bureau, the brilliant musician Quincy Jones. Joining us now by phone is Tony Bennett, the man that Frank once called the best singer who ever lived. Tony, I've heard that you have had a really rough time with this today.
Yeah, because, you know, I just felt it was, I wanted to cancel out for the one night, but we've organized it now. It's a Sunday night where they're going to have a service for him, and Caesar's Palace was nice enough to, you know, close out for that night in honor of Sinatra. In fact, at 8:30 tonight, the whole strip is going black, and in honor of, you know, in great respect for Sinatra.
There's every light in Las Vegas goes off tonight at 8:30.
Every single light in Las Vegas will go black.
For about a minute or two,
But, you know, I have Steve Wynn here also.
Steve,
next
put him
to
on.
Me. I'm at his fabulous hotel here. You might want to talk to him also.
I sure will.
All right.
It's because Steve employed Frank, did he not?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
At the Golden.
And Tony, how did you feel when he said you were the best?
Well, it actually changed my whole life. And, you know, one time at Radio City, I was sitting with his wonderful wife, Barbara, and I was watching him, enjoying him. And he turned around to the audience and he said, I want you to meet not only my best friend in show business, but my best friend personally. And he had me stand up. Well, I've never gotten over that. To this day, you know, we just became the best of friends forever. And it's, you know, Frank Sinatra, I guess everybody knows, will live forever and ever. Mm-hmm. And it's
as long as there's music.
Unbelievable loss.
His
you know, Larry, what are we going to do without a Frank Sinatra world, right?
Yeah, what do we do without it?
No, it'll always be a Frank Sinatra world. As long as there's music, there'll be Frank Sinatra.
Paul Anka, loyalty was a big factor of Frank's, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
If he liked you, he liked you.
He hung in with you. He was a man's man. And once you had his word, that was it.
Right, Don, right? Right, right. You wouldn't want to be... What are you doing?
I think I'm on an airplane. Check, right, right.
You wouldn't want to be his enemy.
No, certainly not. I have a friend of mine that was his enemy. Dead.
Frank was tough.
Yeah, he was tough, but he was great to his friends. I mean, he liked Quincy, he loved Steve, he liked me. He wasn't too crazy about you. That I tell you off the record. You know what I mean? I'm sorry, God rest his soul, he's not here to tell you. He didn't like you.
They never faked it when he was nice.
Yeah, well, he would try to be nice. He leaned over, if you noticed. You know, look at the interview close. He's leaning over, spitting up a little bit on the
you
side.
You know, Larry, I'm not sure, but I think the interview he did with you was probably not only the last one, but I think it was probably the only interview he did on television in years.
I think since Ed Morrow, person to person. He didn't like attention like that kind. He was just...
You know what I noticed, which is interesting? He didn't like to be touched too much, you know? With the putting the arm around, like he has that same problem. Quincy doesn't have the problem because Quincy and I like each other. He's annoying. But he never liked if you made too much
Don,
of
Don, he didn't want to touch you, but he touched a lot of women.
Yeah. God bless that,
Larry. Larry, this is Paul.
Yeah.
Larry, the other thing about Frank was if you had the wrong perfume on or toilet water, he would vacate a room so quickly or have you thrown out. I always remember that about it. Once he went, what's that? Out!
Paul's got to leave us because he's got to work. Thanks for joining us, Paul, and thanks for your contributions to the world of music and, of course, to the Sinatra. When we come back, more with the panel on Larry King Live. Don't go away.